Hey there, and welcome to Beer Branding Trends, conversations on building stronger craft beverage brands. Kodo Design has spent more than a decade working with craft food and beverage artisans, helping them to brand or rebrand, reposition, and reimagine what a compelling F&B brand can be. This show captures all of our fieldwork and experience into practical strategies, tips, and tactics to help you build a stronger brand and sell more beer. I'm Isaac Arthur.
And I'm Cody Fagg.
And this is the Beer Branding Trends Podcast. Hey, Cody, what's up?
Not a whole lot, Isaac. How are you doing today?
Cody, I am exquisite. Today, we're going to be diving into the second episode of our Package Refresh series. As a reminder, this is Kodo Design's three-part exclusive newsletter series on why package refreshes are such an important trend in the beer industry today.
Isaac, I've got a question for you.
Cody, shoot.
Isaac, now, where can people read this newsletter series of which you speak?
Oh, Cody, that's a great question. I'm glad you asked. Our listeners can head over to beerbrandingtrends.com and join the newsletter to read this exclusive series.
Isaac, thank you.
Cody, the pleasure is all mine. Thank you for the reminder. We should also tell people to like and subscribe the podcast and do all that stuff. We paid a consultant a while back to tell us how we could increase and improve the podcast, and her feedback mostly boiled down to that. So we paid a lot of money to have someone tell us that we need to constantly remind our listeners to subscribe and leave reviews. That's terrific. All right, let's back up. In our last episode, we laid out why package refreshes are such an important trend in the brewing industry right now. Today, we're going to explore the line between package refreshes, brand refreshes, and rebrands, why the differences between these processes matter, and how to ensure that you're addressing the right problem in the first place. I think the subhead in this newsletter issue was package refreshes can drive amazing results if you don't have a brand problem. So let's start, before diving into that, let's just get some quick definitions out so we have a lay of the land and our listeners understand kind of what we're actually talking about.
Sure. Let's start by laying out how we frame any conversation we have with our clients ahead of any type of revamp, no matter what it is. And that's a nice rule of thumb, you know, evolution versus revolution. And we really like this because it helps to understand our clients' intent, their situation, you know, what it is we're trying to do. And if it's not too corny, I'll read directly from our second book here, Craft Beer Rebranded.
Cody, let me stop you right there.
Isaac, what is it?
Now, Corey, where can people find and buy this craft beer? No, just go ahead. I'm sorry. Don't. Let's just get to it.
No, I mean, that's a great question. I'm glad you asked. You can grab that book at craftbeerrebranded.com.
Okay, thank you. All right, I will not do that again. We will not, there's no more of that.
Good.
That's obnoxious. All right, what were we going to read?
Well, the quote I was going to read before you cut me off to start shilling the book that I was already shilling.
Shill masters.
Okay, on evolution versus revolution. Mm-hmm. Are you completely reshaping your brewery's culture and positioning? Are we throwing your logo out with the bathwater and creating wholesale visual change across the board? Or are we building on decades of work and hard-earned goodwill to make subtle updates in a natural progression? Would it be a misstep to jettison the visual signifiers and concepts behind your company as it stands? Or does it make more sense to build upon, hone, and enhance what already exists?
Damn, that is well written. I wonder who put that together. I just want to say that it is okay if you're not sure which path is correct right now. So if you're a brewery thinking about some sort of revamp, you're not sure if you need to evolve or need to really make some big changes. We do like this heuristic because it does help us and our clients kind of get a good idea of what problems you're trying to address and what you want to achieve through the process in really kind of a short amount of time. So it's a great conversation starter at the very least. Let's get back to these definitions now, now that we've got some kind of fuzzy philosophical considerations out of the way. So, Cody, please quickly define what we mean when we say, you know, rebrand, brand refresh, and then I guess we probably buried the lead here, but the package refresh, which is what we're actually here focusing on.
Okay. Rapid fire here. So let's start with rebrand. A rebrand represents a shift in your core messaging and positioning. So this is something that starts with upstream business and brand strategy considerations. So kind of the soft abstract stuff, including your long-term vision, deciding what spaces you want to compete in, how your brewery is positioned, how you want people to perceive who you are and what you're doing, what you're selling. And this is also a process of defining your most compelling and ownable differentiators. So things like brand values and key messaging pillars, really far upstream. All of this brand strategy, once developed, should drive the look and feel of your brand identity and packaging. This would be a revolution in our metaphor or our heuristic. You're really going into the roots and digging everything out and rebuilding from scratch. By contrast, a brand refresh is more of a visual surface level identity update. If you like the house building metaphor, you can call it a fresh coat of paint. In this scenario, your brand values and positioning, you know, most of that foundational strategy stuff we were talking about, you know, during the rebrand that I was just describing, all that still holds true. But your brand identity and packaging may just need some level of updating, either because it looks stale in the market or any number of other reasons that don't have to do with your sort of core reason for being. This work will build on or evolve your existing identity, so it's not a sweeping change, but rather an evolution, or you can kind of see how you got from point A to point B to point C in this type of approach and in a brand refresh approach. And then finally, a package refresh is when you update your packaging on its own. And in this instance, you're leaving your core brand identity as is. So no brand, no rebrand, no brand refresh, just the packaging itself. So the end result would be new packaging adorned with your existing logo and kind of those deeper secondary and tertiary identity components. How's that?
That's great. Thank you. I will add that package refreshes are kind of tactical projects, and they can make a lot of sense when your breweries, again, just to echo that, your positioning, messaging, and broader brand, and in particular, your identity are good to go, and your packaging just needs a facelift. So this process focuses more on addressing pain points and inconsistencies than like if we're helping you reposition or rebrand, where we're, you know, usually tackling more of kind of an existential crisis. Who are we 25 years in? Who is our audience? That sort of stuff. So a package refresh can work really well when just kind of a laundry list here, your brand strategy work, you know, positioning, messaging, values, voice, personality, all that stuff you mentioned a moment ago is compelling and aligns with where you want to take your business in the coming years. They can work well when your core brand identity is in good shape. You know, you have a robust brand identity system. You're not really running into pain points when it comes to production or developing merchandise and stuff like that. They work well if you have not updated your packaging in several years. I think we talked about that last time where, you know, 4 or 5 years, if you haven't updated it, might be a good time to do it given the changes we've seen in the market. I'll also add that package refreshes can be great when your sales are flat but not in free fall. We discussed that in our last episode as well. Or when your sales are trending up and you want to capitalize on that and maintain that momentum. And then finally here, kind of when you've got a squared away and energized team that's ready to hit the streets and move some beer. So I don't know, Cody, I think that's a pretty good list. Do you have anything to add?
There's one more. And this is a situation when market or competitive sets out on the shelf, when those changes have presented you with an exciting opportunity. So some examples we've seen in our recent project work could include like a major local competitor is closing up shop, wholesaler consolidation has affected you in some way, or if there's even new advantageous legislation passing in your market, or you just see an opportunity on the shelf to put something up there that nobody else is doing. I think that can be a good opportunity for a package refresh as well.
Great point. Yeah, you're right. So if any of this criteria is met, then a package refresh can be a great investment, especially when compared to a more costly rebrand. So again, I'll kind of refer you back to our last episode to hear a deep dive on these examples and these reasons that are driving refreshes in general. Let's now get into some of the important nuances of the package refresh process. Cody, the first point in our outline here is actually a question, and that is, how big a swing can you take?
Yeah, and I like this setup. It's an interesting thing to unpack. So we spoke earlier about the concept of evolution versus revolution, or in other words, you know, how drastic a change are you making? And when we talked about that, I think we were talking about branding kind of upstream of packaging. But what's interesting here is I think this applies to the package refresh process as well. In other words, do you want to subtly evolve your packaging or take a bigger swing than that? And how should your visual and brand equity inform this decision? Our usual caveat here is that every project, background context, and competitive set is going to differ. and therefore every situation is going to call for a different solution. However, I would offer a package refresh doesn't have to be as limiting as a brand refresh in many respects.
Yeah. In other words, this is confusing. Don't let the term refresh limit you here.
Yeah. It's kind of confusing, right? Because
wait, I thought a refresh was a lighter touch, but you're telling me that we can take a bigger swing on our packaging.
Right. Yeah. That's just a weakness of the semiotics at this point. I mean, sure. You can change your package design, I think even dramatically so, through this process, provided you shake all those fences and make sure that it makes sense. Mm-hmm. So assuming this is a true package refresh and we're not updating your brand identity, you know, then your logo, along with any sort of core visual equity, things like SKU colors or a longstanding packaging composition, those things should provide enough continuity to ensure that your update doesn't push too far away from where you stand today. And in this way, a package refresh can be an opportunity to take a bigger departure from where your packaging currently sits, so long as it aligns with your project and positioning goals.
Probably worth echoing again that your mileage may vary here. We're speaking very broadly. That's a challenge of the show. You know, we want to give people kind of advice, but we have to be very vague and broad because just we don't have a specific project in front of us right now. But
right. So if you do this and you screw it up, it is not our fault.
If you do it and you find just tremendous success, please leave us a review.
Yeah. In that case, it is a result of our thinking and everything we put out
here. And our thinking alone and not your hard work.
And all we have to say is you're welcome. In all seriousness, listeners should check out our episode with Fernson Brewing. Maybe more importantly, check out our case study there with them for a great example of a package refresh that really departs from where they were previously.
Yeah.
You know, from their previous packaging's look and feel, it took a pretty big leap.
Good call. Yeah. It's just now getting out in the wild as well, but I'd say our work with would be another good example there. So we'll link to both of those in the show notes. Let me hit you with a counter to the idea that we just spent 3 minutes talking about, and that is when your equity calls for a refresh.
Let me hit you with a counter. Why don't you take this one?
Oh man, a counter. I was playing Uno with my 7-year-old yesterday.
The reverse. Yeah.
She hit me with she hit me with a draw 4 and I think I hit her with a draw 4 reverse. I don't remember how it worked out. I don't even know. My wife and I don't even know if the rules were correct. But my daughter ended up drawing like 9 cards and I drew none, and that game didn't end too well. So, all right. It wasn't as fantastic an explosion as like when, Monopoly goes off the rails. But all right, what are we talking about? A counter to everything we just laid out. So an argument against making too drastic a change would be if your packaging has enough visual equity that you do need to evolve it through your update. We've explored visual and brand equity at length on the newsletter and on this podcast here. We'll include several links in the show notes for, you know, kind of the best, you know, the most popular pieces we put out on that topic. But for now, the risk of pushing too far and not honoring your visual and brand equity through a package refresh is real. People can easily lose track of you on shelf. They can become confused. They can become alienated by the change, you know, if it's really not handled properly. And with thousands of other options really just available at anyone's disposal at any time, no matter where they're buying their alcohol, they can just simply move on without a second thought. I mean, it's not even a very dramatic, I think we kind of build this up in our minds of like our customers don't want to buy us anymore. It's so dramatic. I don't think it is. I think they just buy something else and move on with their day. So, but anyway, waffling back to our earlier point now, if you do see a big enough opportunity, or if that equity doesn't align with where you want to take your brand over the coming years, you do not need to be overly precious about it. That's our broader point. If your project context, your brand strategy, your competitive set, your project goals, your pain points, and just your broader vision for your business, all of these things will dictate whether or not this is a strategically sound path. I think I might have made a clear point in there. I don't know. Is that good?
Yeah, that all tracks. We'll probably move on to our next point.
Okay. And this is a fun one on brand strategy, and specifically whether or not you need to work through your strategy as part of this process. We've hinted at this idea a few times now, Cody. We should probably address it head on. Just go. Take it from there.
Sure. You know, if we had everything our way, and if budget and timeline were not a limiting factor, which of course it always is, but if it wasn't, we would work through formal brand strategy on every single major engagement that we take in. Kind of back to our series thesis, one of the biggest reasons why your brewery might consider a package refresh in the first place is that you can occasionally get away with not working through strategy. You know, in other words, it means you're looking at a faster overall project timeline. And you can potentially save a lot of money there too, in terms of that strategy work. But back to our earlier point, in order for this to work, you have to be 100% confident that your positioning, key messaging, values, brand voice, personality, and your identity system and all the kind of bells and whistles there are all in a solid place, are all set up to help you build your brand over the coming years. You need to be absolutely sure that a package refresh is what's needed to solve whatever problem is that you want to address in the first place. Because if the issue isn't there in the packaging, then you're not going to accomplish anything.
Yeah. And we mean this directly as a caution. The reason we push for brand strategy as often as we do, you know, if I know you got a lot of clients that work with or that are listening to the show as an example, so they probably heard this. But the reason we push for strategy as often as we do is that without working through that process, there's no mechanism for your team or even your design partner to verify that you are actually correct, that your brand strategy and your identity is good to go. So, I mean, just what that looks like is let's say we don't do strategy. You kick off a package refresh, and then later on you realize that there's a deeper issue at hand. It's like, oh, whoops, uh-oh. And that's going to require a pretty big audible later on, which is a very nice way of saying that you got to pause, you got to rescope the project, you got to extend the timeline, you got to find more money, you know, develop a new budget. So there's just a lot of stuff that you don't want to be discussing, you know, 6 weeks into a project that you thought was squared away and ready to go.
Yeah. And, you know, in all instances, this will be a project that already has a fast timeline because sure. That's just what it is now. We should probably also say that you, or I guess the client here, you can be right about your diagnosis. So we worked with
Let me rudely interrupt. Yeah. We don't mean to be like to position Kodo or any designer as gatekeepers at all.
Yeah, I mean, we've worked with some really brilliant clients throughout the beer and beverage industry. Folks you'd be happy to work with again or hire and work with on a regular basis. So this isn't a critique of clients writ large, and we're not saying anything about your ability to measure your brand's effectiveness. What this comes down to is a matter of perspective. Working every day at the brewery means you're closer to your brand and your business and all the moving parts of everything that you're doing. You're closer than any outsider can ever be. However, this closeness can hinder your ability to be objective about what's happening or more germane. It's going to affect how well your brand and brand identity are performing and your ability to assess that. My advice here is always just to be open to using brand strategy as a diagnostic tool to make sure a package refresh will help you accomplish your goals and to really test that out rigorously before you dive into that.
Yeah, well put. And that tees up one of the most important points to think about before you dive into a package refresh here. And that is to make sure that you are actually, or that you are, I should say that you are not actually dealing with a capital B brand problem.
Yeah, and this is kind of a recap of our last point, but from a different angle. I agree that this is super important and it probably does bear repeating here. A package refresh can be a great investment if your brand and brand strategy stuff are on point. In other words, you're on a strong foundation there. So are you facing a surface level packaging and portfolio and competitive set problem? Or is there possibly a deeper brand issue at hand?
Cody, what are some things that point to more of a surface level problem or surface level fix?
Sure. And I think we kind of touched on a couple of these, but just to rehash them for the sake of discussion and jump in here at any time, but just some stuff, quick stuff that comes to mind. First one you mentioned earlier, your packaging is inconsistent. So, you know, over time, it doesn't hold together quite the way it should from one SKU to another.
That's almost... I mean, I can't actually think of a project where that hasn't been at play.
Sure.
And that's with like some of the biggest breweries in the country down to, you know, smaller. It's just everyone's portfolio gets inconsistent over time. Yeah.
And this is kind of building on that same point, but sometimes it's the case that your naming convention is inconsistent. So some beers may have fanciful names. Some have more monolithic parent brand names. Some are just named by style, et cetera, et cetera. So there's no real thread connecting how beers are named and presented.
We see IP issues still to this day,
right,
well, that they're kind of like maybe not an existential problem, but like a little thorn in your shoe. You're just kind of constantly thinking about, you know, we should probably change that name. That's either not trademarkable or it's very clearly, you know, kind of impeding on someone else's IP.
What else here? Maybe you've seen several key competitors recently rebrand and update their packaging, and they're seeing a lot of play and a lot of response just based on that. something that's happened a lot all over the country and all over the world. And then we've said this one earlier too, but when your packaging hasn't been updated for several years, and that kind of ties into the last point, but it's, I don't want to say it's expected because it depends on your brand and what you're trying to do. And you may have the type of brand where your packaging never changes for 25 years, and that's the point, and that's totally valid. But the general rule here that we're seeing is to get distributors excited, to get retailers excited, putting a fresh coat of paint on the packaging, tightening things up, making things a little bit more readable, and making them broadcast a little bit better on the shelf. That's been kind of a thing that we're seeing across breweries and across beverage companies as well. What else here? I'm kind of running on fumes on this one.
No, that's good. Just a couple others that kind of jump top of mind here. When you're seeing flat to, I'll even say slightly declining sales, so you're not dealing with like really terrifying deep year-over-year losses. And then we've probably said this a couple different ways, but really just if your packaging is not attractive, you know, we don't need to sugarcoat this. If your packaging looks like and that's a bummer. You know, your team's out there breaking their backs, they're making the best beer they can make. Your sales team's out there, you know, kind of pushing this stuff. So it's just sad. And it's like putting an ugly cover on a phenomenal book. Will someone pick up that book with an ugly cover? Will someone buy your beer with terrible packaging?
Yeah, people with poor taste will buy your beer with terrible packaging. Well,
we can always count on people with bad taste, but do we want those people to buy our beer? Maybe you do. I don't know. Their money's green too. So, Cody, we were just talking about surface level things. What are a couple points that might point to, if someone's out there listening to this and they're not sure whether or not they are good to go with a package refresh, or maybe there is that kind of deeper upstream positioning and brand problem, what are a couple points that might kind of help them shake that loose?
And even though some of the stuff is kind of abstract, the situations here can be pretty apparent. So a good example.
I agree. Yeah. Actually kind of counterintuitive, but maybe clearer with the more existential. Yeah.
If you have no clear, compelling story, like, you know, somebody pins you down in an elevator and says, hey, what's your thing? And you don't know where to start. You don't know how to hook them. That's a pretty clear issue that there's a broader capital B brand problem going on there. If you find yourself chasing trends around, both in beer and in the fourth category, kind of beyond beer stuff, you know, and you never quite seem to hit. If your distributor and retail partners, you know, they're not bought in, they're not pushing your brand, they seem to be kind of pushing you to the side. I think that can point to some deeper issues as well for, you know, how the brewery is perceived or how your products are perceived. And then you mentioned kind of seeing a gradual decline. Now, if you're seeing a steep decline in sales, you know, up in that 15, 20, 25% year-over-year loss, sometimes for multiple years running, I think there is a good chance that you might have a core problem with your communication that a package refresh is not going to necessarily address.
Yeah, and the reason we're here saying that is that any agency that is worth, you know, anything doesn't want to take your money and give you fancy new packaging that doesn't help you sell more beer. So just pause. Figure out if there's something deeper at play. You know, is your portfolio made up correctly? Are your sales program or is your sales program squared away? Even back to like early on with your ABP, like, are you getting out there and getting after it correctly and framing it correctly? And this could even be stuff that's like firmly outside of our scope, but is your beer priced right? You know, are your COGS squared away? This is stuff that we can't talk about really, but yeah, probably a bigger problem than just needing a new can, you know, a new can design.
So if you're dealing with problems from the former group of criteria that we listed earlier, then a package refresh can be a phenomenal option. If you're dealing with more existential problems from the latter group that we spoke about there, don't fret. This can be resolved as well, but it will take more than a package revamp to get you where you need to be. You really need to dig in and address, you know, wherever that problem is. Is there anything else to add here?
No, we could probably wrap up here. Cody, take us home.
Okay.
Do it well.
I'll do my best, I promise.
Do not let me down.
A package refresh can be a great option if your brand identity and strategy are working well, if you're squared away there. If they are not, then a refresh at the packaging level is not likely to have the impact that you're after. And if that's the case, you'll likely end up worse off than if you had done nothing because you've invested your time and probably your money into this change to accomplish nothing.
Yeah, just confused everything. Yeah.
Right. Muddied the waters. So make sure you take stock of your identity and strategy before deciding if a refresh is the best course of action. Really take that like completely zoomed out view of the business and maybe get some objective eyes on it if you can. And if you determine you're not dealing with a brand problem, then you can move forward and refresh your packaging in confidence, save some cash, increase your sales. How's that sound?
Cody, that's I'll allow it. That's pretty good. Thank you. All right. Tune into our next episode for the startling conclusion of this three-part series on package refreshes. Cody, we're going to sit down next week. Well, it'll come out here in a couple weeks, but we're going to set all the theory stuff aside, and we're going to discuss some of the finer points and kind of wonky process best practices that we have kind of picked up for managing your package refresh after now handling several dozen of these over the last several years. So how can you actually refresh your packaging? Thank you for listening. Please subscribe. Tell a friend about this show. Cody, thank you for your time today as always, and we'll catch up with you all soon.
Goodbye.
Thanks for listening to Beer Branding Trends. If you like what we're doing here, if you find this valuable, please rate and review us over on iTunes. And head over to beerbrandingtrends.com to join more than 5,000 subscribers who receive our monthly email newsletter covering strategy, currents, and actionable advice from Kodo Design, a branding firm on the front lines of beer and beverage branding. Take care. We'll catch back up with you soon.